Welcome to the .NET Way. You're watching episode 11 of our .NET Core interview series. Today, we're tackling a topic that can make or break your application's security: model binding and validation. Get this wrong and you open the door to bad data, crashes, and even security vulnerabilities. Let's hear how senior developer Aarohi architects robust APIs that handle user input safely and correctly every single time. Aarohi, let's start with the basics. What is model binding?
Model binding is the process where ASP.NET Core maps request data, like form values, query strings, or JSON bodies, to C# objects.
Where does the framework get the data to bind?
Model binding can pull data from root values, query strings, form fields, headers, and the JSON body. We can also be explicit using attributes like from query, from root, or from form.
What if required data is missing or invalid?
If the data doesn't match the model structure, the model state becomes invalid. And this is a key feature. When you're using the API controller attribute, the framework handles this for you automatically. It short-circuits the request and returns a standardized 400 bad request with a detailed error response. It's a huge time saver and ensures consistent behavior.
How do you validate the bound data?
I use data annotations like required, email address, or range directly on DTO properties.
Do you use Fluent Validation?
Yes, I use it when validation rules become complex or need more logic. It's a separate library where we define validator classes and register them in dependency injection. It keeps validation clean and separate from models.
Can you customize validation messages?
Yes, with data annotations, I can specify a custom message. For example, I can use required field validation on the name property. With Fluent Validation, messages are fully configurable. I also use middleware to format responses consistently.
What if a user sends extra properties not meant to be modified?
Overposting is a serious security risk. The golden rule here is to never expose your database or domain models directly to the client. My strategy is always to use specific data transfer objects, or DTOs, for each action. This DTO contains only the fields that are meant to be modified, creating a secure contract with the client. It's the cleanest and safest approach.
Some people use the bind attribute. Is that a good practice?
Bind lets you pick which properties to include, but it's not scalable. Using DTOs is cleaner and more maintainable, especially as the model grows.
What if you have nested objects or lists?
ASP.NET Core validates nested models and collections automatically. With attributes like validate complex type or fluent validation, I ensure even nested data like addresses or order items are validated properly.
What's your strategy for testing validation logic?
I write unit tests using fluent validation test helpers or by checking data annotation behavior. For integration, I send real requests through Postman or automated tests to confirm the API returns correct error messages.
That was a solid breakdown of model binding and validation. Well done, Aarohi. Getting this right is key to preventing bugs and vulnerabilities and ultimately building applications that your users can trust. If you found this helpful, give us a like, leave your questions below, and subscribe to the .NET Way. In episode 12, we'll dive into JWT authentication and role-based authorization in ASP.NET Core. See you in the next episode.